Sorry for the delay. Yeah, there was some technical just now. So I guess we can just straight away go to the app. This would be more of a sharing session on core image. So basically, core image, you are able to do like add filters. And besides adding filters, I'm also going to show you how to do face detection, like how you do for Facebook. So for tagging and everything. Okay, so first thing first, how the app is going to look like. Let me just play it. Okay, now this is, it always kind of lag when it's connected with too many wires. So I've already downloaded it onto my iPhone, so it looks something like this. Okay, this is just a simple scroller that I do so that I can just scroll to different photos. Okay, oops. Okay, then as you can see here, these are all the filters that I've added, but there are more filters than this. For tonight, I'm going to show you four types of filters and how we're going to do it. So for the first one, it's going to be monochrome. Monochrome, we can just add a color, whether is it blue, red, or whatever color, and it will try to make that photo just to have that one color only. And we have the sepia, so let me just reset this. Go to sepia, and it straight away turns into sepia. Reset it, go into instant, so it now has the instant filter. So it really looks like your Instagram filter. Okay, and is it hard to do? I would say it's not really that hard to do because the core image has all these functions which you can use. Okay, so first thing first, let me just show you the storyboard that I use. Kind of lags. Anyway, like normal. Okay, so here I'm going to show you. Okay, so I can't really see. Okay, so we have I've connected the monochrome button, the noir button, sepia, and the instant button, and I've also add actions to them, IB actions, so that when I click on them, something will happen. So let's just dive in into what happens when I press the monochrome button. So when I press the monochrome button, let's just go here. Press monochrome. Okay, and I will go to apply monochrome. Okay, so to do that filter which I just show you how to do the monochrome, is just this small snippet of codes, and that's it. You are able to do the filter. So first thing first, there's a list of instructions that you can follow so that you can make sure that every time you try to add a filter, you will get it. So first thing first, you need to set up the context. Okay, initiate. Then after that, the CI image. Next, the filter. So this is where the magic happens. So you get the filter and name that filter whatever filter that you want. So for the monochrome filter, it's just as easy as putting it as CI color monochrome. So what are the other filter category that you can have? Okay, so I've done NS logout, which is somewhere here. So for this part, I'm just going to focus on the color effect category. So from here, I can see what are the color effects category that is being supported on my iPhone. For OS X, there might be something more. I'm not so sure, but I'm just focusing on iOS today. So as you can see from here, these are all the filters that is supported on my iPhone, which I can use. Okay. So the one that I'm using is CI Color Monochrome, CI Sepia Tone, CI Photo Effect Noir and Instant, Instant and Noir. Okay. So let's go back to that piece of code. Okay, so once we get the filter, we set the value. What type of value can we set? We have to take a look at the library. Yeah, you can go to the online, to the web one, or you can just go to the inbuilt one. Okay, so for so here they show you a whole list of category that you can do. You can even do blur, you can change the colors, the RGB, you know, and all that. This more on for designers, so if you have like some designing background, you'll be able to understand better on what each of these do. And the only one that I'm going to focus on tonight will be the color effect. Is it color effect? Yeah, yes, okay, correct, yeah. This is just going to be a color effect. We also have the composite operation, and the list just goes on. Yeah. So okay. So for monochrome, I want to see what type of inputs, what type of parameters I can input into the filter. So these are the parameters that I can play around with. One would be the input image, input color, and input intensity. It's very important to have the input image, because if you do not have any input image, there's nothing for you to filter. So the input color, this one you can just leave it blank. But I did not put it blank for this one because there's no default value. So maybe you can just try it later. And for input intensity, the default value is 1. So I just leave it to a default value. If you put it at a higher value, it will just be more. For example, the blue monochrome that I have is just going to be much deeper or darker. How to put it? That will be more blue, I would say. Yeah. So yeah, this is a sample output, and if you go back to my app, because I set it to blue color. The thing with score image, right? It works perfect on the iPhone, but with the simulator, there's going to be a bit of lag. So when I press it, it will actually take some time before it turns. Yeah, I'm not sure why, but yeah, it might be a bug on Apple side. I do not know. Okay, so this is the monochrome. I add the blue color. So if I'm going to add any other color, red color or yellow color, is up to you actually. And the library will just adjust it for you according to the color that you want. So instead of, as you can see here, the parameter is input image. You can either use the given key, which is KCI input image key, or you can just do it something like this. Yeah, it's the same thing. Yeah, it's just that, oops. There's actually a capital I. Yeah. So either one will work. There are a few keys that Apple do not provide, so you actually have to manually type it out in string format. Yeah. Okay, so let me just put that to input image key again. Okay, so I set the parameter for the input image and for the input color. And if I want, I can also put for the input intensity, but I'll just leave that to default. So Yeah, I just leave it as one right now. So you can leave it blank also, so you can like comment it out and it will still work. It will just use the value of one. Okay, then at the end of it, you want to get the output image. So to get the output image, you're gonna have, it's going to be as simple as this, the filter, and just get the output image, and you get the CI image for it. Okay, then after that, I'm not sure whether it's a bug or not for the moment, because if I do not resize it and my phone is at a retina display at 2x, so what's going to happen is that when the output image is being generated, it won't be generated as what I put here will be, something as 286233, but because it's like retina display is at 2x, so it actually goes up to 5, yeah, times 2 of this, so it actually expands the image. So because of that, this is just a small hack that I do to resize the image back to the original size. Yeah. Then after that, yeah, after I resize it, this is the correct way to actually get the CG image, to convert the CI image to CG image, and then from the CG image convert it to UI image. Yeah. So there's actually a function that UI image provide that will allow you to straight away convert the CI image. To straight away convert the CI image to an UI image. But for this library, this function is not going to work properly. It's always going to have a very weird sizing for it. So I've looked through Stack Overflow and I've asked a few people. We all have this problem. So this is not the right way to get the UI image from the CI image. The correct way is to change the CI image to a CG image, then from CG image turn to a UI image. Yeah, it's one big round, I do not know why. Yeah. And at the end of it, because I create a CG image reference, I will need to release it. Yeah. This part we call Cloud Library. Yeah. It's a bit weird because I know we do not need to use dialog, but we still need to release for core graphic stuff. Okay, so that's one point to take note when doing this. Because even in the documentation, they don't really explain how to change that CI image back into a UI image. Yeah. So so we get the output image. And let me just show you the auto resize function. Okay. So in the auto resize function, what I did was I add another filter. We have this filter called Langso scale. So what it actually do is that will help us scale. Let me just find CI now. Okay. So this is the one. So the description here says that it will produce a high quality scaled version of a source image. So, and that's why I'm using it. Yeah. So these are the parameters. Input image again. Yeah. For almost all of the filters, this is the one most important parameters that you will have to put in. Then here we're gonna have the scale. So from the scale, what I did was, instead of getting the screen resolution at 2x at 3x, I do not do that. I actually do something like this. So I get my image view, the width, and then I divide it by the image being generated. This is the CI image being generated, the width. So and from there I can convert it back to the image view bound. Okay. And the key is going to be KCI input scale key. Okay, this extend is so this is the the bound of the image being generated, the core image being generated. So because mine is on a retina display, so what I suspect is that the when they read this image, it will not read it as 286 by 233, it will actually get my retina image, which is double this size. So when it return back the extent, it actually uses that that value. So that's why I need to actually resize this and then get the output image, return it back. Return it back here before I start converting the CI image back to UI image. Yeah. So once I get the UI image, I will get the effect. Okay. Yeah. So from the apply monochrome and to the auto resize, this is one technique called chaining the filter. So we actually have one filter here, which we are using the CI color monochrome filter, and then I chain it to the CI Lamso scale transform filter. Okay, and because of that, I'm also able to like for example, like Instagram, you can only use one filter at a time. They don't allow you to combine, but with this, you are actually able to combine. So I can go for monochrome and I add it to Sepia. Then I can even add it to Instant, and then after I add it to Noir. Yeah. So that's the cool part of the CI image here. Yeah. It's not actually just one filter, you can actually change your filter. Okay. So I'll just go through a bit of the other color effect. Okay. So we have the monochrome, we have the chrome effect, the fade effect, the instant effect, mono, which is also similar to Noir, but yeah, I can't really tell the difference because yeah, my one side of the brain is not really working well, so yeah. Yeah, I don't see any difference actually, but okay. Yeah, with the process and yeah, so there's a lot of cool stuff. So besides the one being given to you, you can actually do your custom filter also. But I will not go into that tonight. Yeah, you can actually look into this library, and if you go all the way down, yeah, you can actually do your own custom filter. Yeah, but that's going to be a lot for tonight. So I'm just going to skim the core image library just to give a brief introduction, and hopefully, you know, people can jump start their playing around with this core image library. Okay. So for the rest of the filter is basically the same thing. So context, the CI image, then the CI filter, which is the sepia tone, and for the sepia tone, the it's only one parameter. Let me just check again. Sepia tone. Okay, yeah. So input image and input intensity. So input intensity, I did not put it in. So you can put it in if you want, but yeah. And for the instant, it's also same thing. And the noir is about the same thing. So for the category color effect, is the parameters are all about the same. But if you look into other stuff like gradient and all, the parameters might change. See, so Gaussian gradient. Yeah, you need to put more stuff into it because it's a gradient, so you need two colors and an input radius. Yeah. So if you guys are interested, you all can just go and play around with all the filters here. Yeah. And one of the most interesting one is the blur effect. They have all this type of blurring, yeah. So you don't actually have to go for the normal blurring effect on your main screen. There's actually Apple provides different type of different ways of blurring your image, yeah. Which is kind of cool though, yeah. The one that a lot of people use, I'm not sure whether a lot of people use, but is the Gaussian blur. This is the one that will give you the this type of effect, you know, the background. Yeah. So this is one way of blurring. One technique of how you can achieve this effect by using CI Gaussian blur. There are a few other techniques, but since CoImage provided for me, I'll just use this effect, this technique. Yeah. And then, if you guys are more ambitious, you guys can go into transition. So for transition, only a few of them works. Like copy machine doesn't work on the iOS. Accordion full bar swipe. So I've locked it up for the night also for the transition. Oops, where is it? Transition room. Yeah. So as you can see, the copy. Oh, copy machine is in. Sorry. Yeah. Okay. So copy machine is in. So accordion full transition, bar swipe transition. Let's just side by side. Machine disintegrate, dissolve, flash, mod, swipe, and the rest doesn't work on the iOS. Yeah, but it works on the OS X. Yeah, so you can take a look like what are the effects. So instead of, you know, having just a simple swipe from left to right, you can be a bit more ambitious and, you know, have something like this. Isn't it cooler than just a simple swipe? And for copy machine, it's going to look something like that. Yeah. So, but what I suspect is that this one you will have to look into the eagle view, because it's a bit. Yeah, I'm not so sure whether you need the eagle view. Eagle view will make it is for real time performance. So you can see here. Let's see here. Image settings here. Call image context. Okay. See, the documentation clearly states here that creating a core image content on iOS when you don't need real-time performance, you can just have this for the for creating the context with options. The other option is you have to allocate an eagle context with API, which is the GLES2. I've tried GLES1 and GLES3. It doesn't work on the iOS. They will even give you a warning that only 2 works. Yeah. So, and this is how to create the context. Yeah, but this one is more on the GL kit library. Yeah, so you have to go in a little bit deeper if you want to have a real-time performance. Okay, so that's quite simple for the for applying filter. The next one I'm going to show you is the face detection. So let me just go to my face detection one. Okay, so here we are. So when I go in, so first thing first, I don't need the context for this one. So I can straight away skip the context and straight away get my CI image. And then the next one will be the CI detector. This is the class that is going to help you detect the face. So the here you can set it to high, and I think the other one is low. I think let me just check it out. Detector types. Yeah, low and high. Okay, so depending on what you prefer, can set it. Then so context will be nil, and then I set the options here. And how to get the face being detected, I will have to use an array, and then use this method called features in image. So first I get my UI image, I convert it into CI image, and then I let the detector just do the work for me. And then from there I do a fast enumeration to check for the face features in that array. If they cannot detect any face, this will just be empty. But if there is any face, it's going to return me something and do for me something here. Okay. But face feature, this is actually a child class of another class called CI feature. So you can actually detect other stuff, not only just face. Yeah. So yeah. So from there, get the screen scale. Okay, this one is a little bit of error. This was the previous one I did, but it's not actually a good way to do it. The one that I show in my filter is actually a better way of doing it. If you guys play around with it, you guys will understand why I say this is not the right way to actually resize the thing. So, okay, for CI image, when they get the bound, the funny thing is that the Y axis is going to be inverted. So instead of having the 0, 0 at the top left corner, 0, 0 is going to be at the bottom left corner. Yeah, so for that, you need to invert back the Y origin, and to do that, you need to do a simple calculation, which will, let's say, if 0 to 50 and your Y is actually at 10, this one is going to give you 40, so you have to convert that 40 back to 10. Then you get the right positioning for the bounding box. Then after that, I did a bit of resize. I just want my box to be a little bit bigger, because if it's not bigger, it's going to just connect the two eyes and then the mouth, and then that's it. Yeah, so it doesn't really look too good, so I actually make it a little bit bigger. Yeah. And after that, once I get the points and everything, I get the frame, I just add a UI view with a highlighted layer, with a border layer around it. Yeah, I just set the tag there so that, you know, when I want to delete everything, it's just easy for me to remove everything. Yeah, it's just a lazy way for me to tell myself that there is a bounding box. Yeah, that's about it. It's that simple actually to work with Core Image. Yeah, so when people go around and ask you guys, like, is it that difficult to do an Instagram app? It's actually not that difficult. Yeah, the Core Image library will help you do a lot of stuff. So after this, after you guys look at the basic, where you guys can hit onto will be creating your own filters. Yeah. So I think Instagram have also created their own filters, which is like special for Instagram. So you can also do something like that. And transition. Yeah, you have time to look into transition as well. I did not have time to actually go into transition tonight, but maybe next time, I don't know. Yeah, but transition is really cool. Yeah, if you actually if you manage to get it working, all those boring, you know, sliding of scroll view and all that, it's all going to change once you know how to use the CI transition library. Yeah, your app is going to look much more professional, much more fantastic, and people are going to ask you, like, hey, how you guys do this? How do you do this? Yeah. So yeah. So again, a few things to take note is that the y-axis is always inverted for Core Image, so you have to take note of that. When you draw a box and you find out, hey, how come the box is below, not on top? It should be on top. So it's because the y-axis is inverted. If you go into Stack Overflow and everything, you're going to get this answer too. And the second one that you need to take note is that for different screen resolution, the CI image is going to return that exact value back. So you need to do a bit of resizing. This is one technique of resizing. There are other techniques of resizing, but yeah, it's totally up to you how you want to resize your photo. Okay, so that's about it for Core Image. Yeah. Any questions? No? Okay, thank you. Yeah.